Because if we don't like something, all we gotta do is take him back to the tool. Start working on a little more. And set him back up. Does it happen? Even skeptics say that people do this. Rachel Newcomb was writing for the Washington Post, and she reviewed a book by a woman that was titled God, a Human History. And she made this statement at the conclusion of her article. She said, whatever God may be, at the very least, this book shows us the long history of how humans have made him in our image and not vice versa. Well, Dale Hudson, writing this a website called Why the Next, well, he wrote in this article, Why the Next Generation is Building Their Own God, wrote, as the next generation grows up, there is a danger that they are being led down a path that says, God is whoever you want him to be for you. You also see this in more and more people choosing what parts of the Bible they want to believe and not believe. For many, if the Bible does not line up with their lifestyle, rather than changing their lifestyle, they ignore or explain away the part of God's Word. The end result is we are teaching the next generation, by example, that they can go down the God assembly line, choose whatever they want his attributes and commandments to be. In other words, they can build their own God. And if you want a little help with building your own God or religion, WikiHow offers you a 10-step guide in how to do it. How to create your own God. I'm serious. It's on there. So, where does that leave us at today? You know, we've said a lot, heard a lot from various people about God's getting ready to do something or going to do something, and he's bringing about major changes in the world, in the church, and so forth. Where does this leave us then? It leaves us at the place of having to deal with a very uncomfortable question. And the question is this. Is the image of God I hold biblical? Or created. Now I know our initial reaction is, oh, well, I try not, please. You know, if it is, then there's some things we've got to adjust in the way that we represent this biblical God. For example, we've been talking about this in youth Sunday school this morning. You know, popular rhetorical topic is, if God exists, why is there evil in the world? Because if God really exists, there would be no evil in the world. Well, okay, we could dance around with that for a little while, but may I offer that that question will never be resolved to anyone's satisfaction because the premise is wrong. The premise is, if God really exists, then the world would have to be like I want it to be. There would be no bad stuff happening. Everyone would only have good stuff happening. And life would be as I want it to be. And since life is not like I want it to be, and there's bad people out there, then that proves there's no God. That's not true. You need to check out the Bible to see what God is. God never promised anyone a carefree life with no problems and just blessings poured out every day. And I'm sorry that the TV preacher tells you he does. The TV preacher lives in a multi-million-dollar mansion, makes more money than you'll ever make in your lifetime, and he does it because he tells people stuff like that, and it's not true. But he hooks them with the promise, believe, and one day it will be. But one day never. I know he's not not supposed to say stuff like that. The 11th commandment is thou shalt be nice. And that cancels out the first 10. But the fact of the matter remains that if God does something, and I believe he is, if he's going to have an outpouring on us again, which I believe he will, we're going to have to be willing to let the idols go. And let God be God. And in that process, if we get offended by some assumptions about God, we have to let go. Get over it. But God's not going to change his standards just to suit us. And God's not going to share this temple with an idol. He's not going to share your temple with an idol. He's either Lord, Jesus is either Lord, or he's not. There is no such thing as, well, Jesus is Lord over part of my life, but this part I'm keeping to myself. Then let me tell you, as nicely as I can, he's not Lord at all. You've got an idol. You've got a calf that represents what God wants, what you want God to be. That is not what he is. He requires it all. In fact, I ran across this quote and I thought it fit very well. John Ruskin, who was of all things a 19th century art critic, he seemed to be a godly man too, wrote this. God will put up with a great many things in my human heart, but there is one thing he will not put up with, a second place. He who offers God a second place offers him no place. If we want Jesus to be Lord, he's got to be Lord. If we want to be positioned for another fresh outpouring of the Spirit, we've got to have our own house cleaned first. You know, there's a reason why Peter said judgment first begins in the house of the Lord. But then when it begins there, just imagine what it's going to be like when it spreads to the world. But this got to get right first. So, are we like Aaron today? Maybe we've been disillusioned. Maybe we've been, kind of been out of shape with God because God isn't doing what we think he ought to do. We feel abandoned. We feel like God's brought us this far and then he just disappeared. And we're scared or angry. Have we made an idol to give us comfort? Do we get our favorite preacher's books and say, oh, I like that. Okay, my idols, my God's going to be this for sure. Oh, well, I really like that. My God's going to be this right here too. Do we have any idols? Is our view of God an idol? And maybe not us. We'll get the spotlight off us and throw it on somebody else. It's more fun that way. Maybe there's someone in our life, a loved one in our life, that you really believe knows the Lord, loves the Lord, but they are very off track in their view of God. And maybe you haven't understood why. Or maybe they're like we described last week with we were talking about attachment styles and how people relate to God through their attachment style, and that the Israelites were what we would call a disorganized attachment style because they were like this. 1 minute close to God, next minute, who is God? 1 minute, thank you, Lord, for Moses, next minute, who is Moses? Well, just like that. know one reason why some people get like this? Could be because they've got an idol in their life. And the victory that they so desperately want to find, they can't find in that idol. I'm not going to belabor the point. I've thrown too many dead cows in my life to drag it up. I just want to encourage us with this. And I know you say, oh, it's not very encouraging. But listen, if we get rid of the idols, we get real encouraging. Now, I was thinking about Kate. Kate last week said she was wondering, she was praying and asking God, what ministry do you have for me to do? She's got some issues. She's believing God to heal her up, and we are too. And that kind of limits some of what she's able to do, but she's willing to do it. I'll tell you what it is, Kate. You're an encourager. And you need to find people who are just beat up, beat down by life, and encourage them. And that can be at home, on the phone, that can be when you're out, whatever. But you need to encourage people, because the more you share how God is coming through for you, the more it blesses other people. So that's it for you. And the good thing is we've all got them. And God wants to send us out to spread the good news of the gospel in our own way, in whatever the gift is he's given us to do. That's the way he wants to send us out. But the idols have to go first. So I encourage me, all of us today, to get before the Lord and say, God, is my view of you correct? Or am I looking at you through an idol? I believe it'll take. But when he tells you, be prepared. Because when he starts tearing idols down, folks around you may not like it. Because you're going to change. You're going to be different. You're not going to be able to play the game anymore. And there's no game. I mean, there's no win in the religious propriety game anyway. So Aaron made a calf. Why? They could relate to it. They'd seen it many times. He was the Ptah, the God who was like one of them. And Aaron thought he wasn't really getting into idolatry. He was just helping them relate to God through an image that they were familiar with. And yet, he did promote that idolatry, regardless of his intent. And he did create an image and declare that image to be God. As one commentator said, he broke the second commandment trying to keep the first. Now, next week, we're going to see the conclusion of this little incident. Because if you want to get God busy in your life with the rod of correction, get into idolatry. Because he'll let some things slide for a while. But when his people start getting into idolatry, he responds. And next week, he will respond. Yes, ma'am.
During worship this morning, I got a download, and I was negligent in sharing it, but I really feel like I need to. And the word came to choose this day whom you will serve. And that was it. Just that. But it was very emphatic that God was speaking to us as a corporate body. Choose this day whom
see, you can't serve God and mammon. I'll change that a little bit. Not doing damage to the scripture. You can't serve God and your image of God. It's going to be one or the other. So we need to make sure. And I'm not going to go down the road and say, oh, I think you got a power in your life. I'm not doing that. That's between you and the Holy Spirit. It could very well be. Listen, I know. I'm the only one in here who's getting older. I understand that. But as I get older, the temptation is there to say, well, God, I know you want this, that, and other. But I'm just kind of tired. I keep hearing people talk about this retirement, God. Who understands when you're getting a little older, you just need to kind of lay back and just kind of enjoy life and go to gospel sings and eat a lot of fried chicken and stuff like that. Yeah, I think I like that image the older I get. I understand that. I understand the pressure right now to back off. Back off of all this. Jesus is the only way stuff. Back off from that. And we talked about that in youth Sunday school. They were talking about going to see Billy Graham's museum, wasn't it?
Yeah, okay.
And that I told they didn't know who Larry King was, I don't think. But how, y'all remember Larry? Well, you're okay on that. But anyway, Larry King, who was an atheist, loved get TV preachers on. Because whenever he got a TV preacher on, he would ask the big question that I call it the Sanhedrin question. Because when the Sanhedrin asked Jesus a question about the woman who had five husbands, who should be married to in the afterlife, the Sanhedrin didn't believe in afterlife. To him, it was a totally irrelevant question. So Larry King would ask a question that was totally irrelevant to him. He would ask, is Jesus the only way to heaven? And one by one, there was a, you know, Larry, kind of in my life he is, and in my belief system he is, and but I know there's lots of other ideas out there, and he would keep pressing them on it until he would make them say no. Either directly or indirectly, they would say that. Except for two people. Well, three. I didn't think about John MacArthur. But two people. Billy Graham and Franklin Graham. They stood by the gospel. But I know the pressure today in this multicultural world where everybody says, well, everybody's got their own path. Let people choose their path and God's okay with it. Well, my little image calf God might be okay with it. But the one in the Bible's not okay with it. So I have to choose. Am I going to stick with the God of the Bible or my calf? And there's many other issues today where God says this, the world says that. And you're going to be forced to choose. Am I going to go with what God says or with what my calf says? My calf is evolving on these issues. God is not. That's why this stuff matters. So, pray. Ask God. Is my view of you correct? And if it's not, change it. And if there's an idol in my life, show it. And it's gone. And then you'll be in a much better place. Next week you're going to see one. No, they did not I break the tablets on the ground and the ground opened up. That did not happen. Only in me. But what they have to go through is pretty bad. Did you have any?
2 weeks.
Oh, that's right. Chuck's here now. Oh, you got a real cliffhanger now. This is like the season ender and the season opener next fall.
Yeah.
Let's sing that song one more time. Then we'll be down. If you need prayer for some reason, I'll be up here. Or if you just want to pray at the altar, come up and do that. I encourage everyone to pray for the loved ones in your life that are away from the Lord right now. God is still in the business of bringing people home, of bringing the prodigals back home. And sometimes that process is painful, so we don't need to get in the way. But God knows how to do it. So there may be someone who wants to come up and pray, want me to pray, I'll be happy to do so. If not, we'll sing and be dismissed.
Thank you.
Jesus. Lord, we pray this